It's hard to imagine how a town could sprout from such an unforgiving landscape.
You come to America to look for a better life. They brought with them that hard work ethic.
Hewn out of a mountain, propped up over the water on stilts.
Men who come to Alaska are sometimes renegades, looking for a better life or running away from something.
Built by miscreants and missionaries, merchants and mountain men, women of valor, and ladies of negotiable affection.
They're strong, they're motivated because of hardship.
A kaleidoscope of characters forged a frontier and built a community like no other in America. But before Ketchikan was even a twinkle in God's eye, there were salmon. Who knows when the first salmon spawned along the banks of Ketchikan Creek? According to native lore, the Tlingit people had been setting up seasonal fish camps along the creek since the beginning of time.
Ketchikan Creek is not just any old creek. It's the why that my ancestry came here to this location for thousands of years. Usually arrive by mid-June, men here through the end of September, processing salmon by smoking or sun-drying.
There are probably as many different versions of how Ketchikan got its name as there are people in Ketchikan. There are a variety of variations on it based on a Tlingit word, kan.
When you hear the whooshing sound of the eagle's wings flying by you, in our Tlingit language we say Keshkan. Keshkan means the thunder and wings of an eagle.
There is no one answer that everyone agrees to. The word kan means home or house or even, you know, area belonging to someone. And everyone would say, well, Ketchikan means that it was Kitch's area. Of course, that begs the question, who was Kitch? As far as we know, there was no Kitch.
I asked Forrest DeWitt Sr., I said, how did Ketchikan get its name? He said, well, I think it's Keekshan Han. Han is crick, and Keekshan means white spot on a fish. And a white spot on a fish is a spawned out salmon. Keekshan Han, it means the cycle of life and the continuing cycle of life for many, many generations. And that's a pretty nice name.
Like any valuable treasure, Ketchikan Creek salmon have been a source of contention since the town began. Legend has it that Ketchikan actually started over a fish fight.
Ketchikan in the 1890s was primarily a collection of shacks and a couple of businesses huddled around the mouth of Ketchikan Creek. Loring was a real town, Ketchikan was not. And those two communities ended up going into a battle to the death, so to speak. the folks up in Loring felt that they owned that creek. And they came down here and tried to basically set up nets at the front of the creek and take all the salmon before they could get up the creek. What you ended up with having was a salmon war, where you actually had fist fights and people fighting in boats and stuff at the mouth of the creek. Ketchikan won. Loring still exists. It's a small little village, but Ketchikan is now a real community.
The Lord's army began arriving in Ketchikan in the late 1800s. There to save and to serve, missionaries promised to build schools and churches for the native people if they moved in from their remote villages.
When the missionaries came into this area, we're seeing the need for education, and some of the leaders, the native leaders at that time, they probably agreed with the changing of times that they would see that their children and generations to come would have to have education.
The Episcopalian here in Ketchikan was more domineering, as I understand it. You're going to be an Episcopalian whether you like it or not. You're going to our church, and you're going to go to our school. That was the beginning of assimilation from the Tlingit culture into the Western world.
With native groups no longer scattered throughout coastal southeast, and miners, loggers, and other transient workers constantly coming and going, there was a convergence of people from two very different worlds. The richness of the natural resources in southeast Alaska that enabled native Tlingit people to subsist for millennia was also a siren for pioneers from the lower 48 and beyond. Fishermen from the east coast in Norway. Seasonal cannery workers from China, Japan, and the Philippines. Loggers, miners, and other salty characters. As Alaska's first city, Ketchikan served as a waypoint for the swarms of prospectors hiking their way up to the Klondike during the massive gold rush.
The Klondike gold rush of 1897-98, 100,000 people passed through this area going north. A lot of them didn't get anything up there. They found nothing. And quite a few didn't want to go home and admit they were failures, I guess, so they stopped here on the way back, and that sort of started the boom here in the 1890s. In the early days, certainly, Ketchikan was a mining community. If you go back to the Articles of Incorporation in 1900, of the 100 people who signed that, 80 of them were involved in the mining industry in some way.
After the town started filling up with miners and loggers, then came the merchants, builders, boatmakers, and scow loads of fishermen. By the mid-1920s, Ketchikan was a bustling city of well over 5,000 people, and if one is to believe the Honorable Judge James Wickersham, the town was bustling with vice and corruption.
It was charged that Uncle Sam, while posing as a moralist, is encouraging and in effect maintaining in Ketchikan and Bristol Bay, Alaska, conditions of vice and crime such as cannot be matched elsewhere on this continent. A disreputable and criminal element has invaded and occupied Indian Town, establishing there a red light district with 200 or more bad women, and making it a colony of bootleggers, dope sellers, gunmen, and low-class people who are crowding out the gentle and inoffensive Indians. Ketchikan, Alaska is a terrible town. One might even gather that it is about the worst pest hole in America. It is the wickedest town.
Ketchikan has more historic properties than any other city of Alaska. We built a lot of buildings in the early 1900s, and they remain today.
I guess all these buildings around here are younger than I am.
We have a very committed group of people who want to do everything they can to tell the story of Ketchikan, to protect what we have. Buildings and neighborhoods that are deteriorated and via historic preservation bring those buildings and neighborhoods to life. Creek Street was a good example. It was all a rundown neighborhood, buildings falling into the creek, only a few left. It had played such a role in our history. So many of these other buildings have played significant roles too. You want to be able to document that, remind people of the history of their community. You want to preserve that character in the community.
People haven't paid close attention to their own backyards at their own places. And somehow we did here. So when it was ready to bloom, it did. It bloomed beautifully.
They say history repeats itself, and sometimes I really hope that that is true, because we've got some great history here that's definitely worth repeating.
There's a lot of hard-headed stubbornness here, and that's why we're still here 100 years later.
Preserving our history, and more importantly, sharing it with people. History doesn't have to be dry. Historic colors don't have to be boring. History can really be just the glorious window to your past and understand how this town evolved and why.
The future is pretty solid. We've weathered some pretty tough storms already.
This is a town without pretense. It just gets down. It's bar fight nasty sometimes, you know, but it's also just rich and alive and rough and tumble, and it's fun to be around.